Hi, this is Boris. Welcome to Movie Messenger. If you have been following my channel, you might remember I showed footage from R0PE in my video on one-room movies, movies which take place mainly in one setting. R0PE is a movie directed by the master of suspense himself, Alfred Hitchcock, and released in 1948. Now, I'm going to go as deep as I can, so spoilers ahead. If you haven't watched the movie yet, watch the movie first before watching this video. Before going any further, I would like to say that this is part of the series that I'll be doing called What a Movie or a Certain Series is Teaching Us. So I'll just go as deep as I can in terms of analysis and give you my take of what I've learned and what we can learn from a specific series or a movie. The movie starts with the murder of an Harvard undergraduate, David Kentley. We understand that between the two young men, Brandon and Philip, who did it, Brandon is clearly the dominant one.
I'm only kidding, Brandon. I obviously can't take it as well as you, so I'm turning on you a little.
That's rather foolish, isn't it?
Yes. Very. May I have a drink now?
By all means.
Brandon, played by John Dahl, can't stop romanticizing the act of murder.
An immaculate murder. We've killed for the sake of danger and for the sake of killing. We're alive. Truly and wonderfully alive.
They also wanted to test people just to prove what they assumed they knew already, which was everyone else is stupid and they won't be able to figure out what happened.
Being ever given.
With these people?
They're a dull crew, all right. The Kentleys couldn't be duller if they tried.
We discover later that both are conditioned to think that they are not like the others. Of course, one of them is more convinced of this than the other.
Brandon would sit up till all hours at the master's feet.
Brandon at someone's feet? Who is this Rupert?
He used to tell you the weirdest things, didn't he?
Really? What sort of things?
Well, I suppose Kenneth means Rupert's impatience with social conventions. For example, he thinks murder is a crime for most men, but...
A privilege for the few.
Yes.
A privilege?
Well, I...
The movie clearly puts us in the murderer's perspective. As a matter of fact, a deeper layer of truth is revealed only when Brandon and Philip leave the party room or the living room. For example, Brandon ignores completely what Janet must be feeling and assumes that she's marrying David, the man who has just been killed, for his money.
I'm a poor girl. She's banked everything on hooking David.
Gee.
I'm terribly sorry, but it is a little difficult trying to keep up with your romances. After me came Kenneth, now it's David. Why the switch from Kenneth to David anyway?
Obviously, I think he's nicer.
Well, he's certainly richer.
Janet tells Kenneth, her ex-boyfriend, the story about the day they broke up and reveals that evening, she poured her emotions to David and thus fell for him from then on. She says twice that she feels relaxed when she's with David. Kenneth discovers it only after having that conversation.
Turn up somehow.
Janet.
Yes.
This is hardly the time, but I'm very glad we had that talk.
So am I. And David will be too.
We hear about Rupert Cadell, played by Jimmy Stewart, even before he arrives on the scene. And we understand that he might be the one who exposed Brendan and Philip to those ideas. Once we meet him, we see he has no trouble dealing with people and shutting them up with his witty dialogue and charm.
Mrs. Atwater, may I present Mr. Rupert Cadell?
Delighted.
Thank you.
Mr. Kentley, how do you do, Mr. Kentley?
Rupert Cadell, the housemaster of Somerville.
I used to be.
Then you must have taught my son, David.
Well, pardon me. How do you do?
Hello, chum.
Oh, Miss Walker.
How'd you know?
Brandon spoken of you.
Did he do me justice?
Do you deserve justice? Well, little Kenneth Lawrence, how you've grown.
Hello.
Oh, now come, Kenneth. School's out. You can say it.
Rupert, you're the same as ever. It's awfully good to see you again.
Why?
Well,
don't mind me. Very pleased to see you again.
For a moment, we switch to Rupert's perspective. When it is shown that people pay more attention to what they see on the surface rather than their true content.
Oh, he was thrilling in that new thing with Bergman. What is it called now? The something of the something. No, that was the other one. This was just plain something. You know, it was sort of, you know.
It was right on the tip of my tongue.
Mine too. It was just plain something, I'm sure. I adored it.
And Bergman.
She's the Virgo type. Like all these, you know.
Oh, I think she's lovely.
I once went to the movies. I saw Mary Pickford.
I was mad about her. Didn't you love her?
Oh, the Virgo type, rather. Like all of these.
Well, what did you see her in?
I don't quite recall. The something something. Or was it just plain something?
Rupert confirms the ideas referred to before by Brandon and Philip by his jokes on killing people and how it would help alleviate the social conventions. Was this the inspiration for Purge? Maybe.
Or should be an art. Not one of the seven lively, perhaps, but an art nevertheless. And as such, the privilege of committing it should be reserved for those few who are really superior individuals.
And the victims, inferior beings whose lives are unimportant anyway,
obviously.
As time goes by, everybody starts to get nervous as they are not hearing from David, who was supposed to be there in the first place. Rupert starts to suspect something is wrong, especially when Philip denies the story about him strangling a chicken. Rupert plays a key role in that he's the one who finds out about the murder. For me, he represents the authority. He's to Brandon what Brandon is to Philip.
He rose?
That's a lie!
Philip!
There's no word of truth in the whole story. I never strangled a chicken in my life.
Now look here, Philip.
I never strangled a chicken, and you know it.
Forgive me, but it just seemed very funny, you two being so intense about an old dead chicken.
Sorry, we were ridiculous and very rude. I apologize for both of us and the story.
I was thinking, wouldn't it be more suspenseful to show the murder at the end and let the audience wonder whether these two young men really did something to David, or if they are just playing a gag on their party guests? If this was the case, I think that would have taken away the moral weight that this movie can have. Putting you on the murderer's side makes you an accomplice in a way, and not only a spectator, or in this case, a guest. At a certain point, the characters have a discussion about Friedrich Nietzsche's theory of Übermensch, or Superman. It's quite fascinating to link it with the Superman that most people know nowadays. I don't believe in coincidence until I come across one. Here's the Instagram post from Henry Cavill, who plays Superman Clark Kent in the DC Extended Universe. In case you can't read what I've highlighted, in January 1933, Jerry Siegel wrote a short story titled The Reign of the Superman, which was illustrated by his friend Joe Schuster and self-published in a science fiction magazine. It told the story of a bald villain with telepathic powers. Trying to create a character they could sell to newspaper syndicates, Siegel reconceived the Superman character as a powerful hero sent to our world from a more advanced society. But in the beginning, as you can see, even the creators made Superman a villain. So the concept of a real Superman is actually terrifying. Now, you might remember in the beginning of this video I said that one of the two young men seems more dominant. After watching the making of, I discovered that the sexual undertone is actually from the original play called Rope's End from an English playwright called Patrick Hamilton. The two main characters were actually gay in the original play. It was even implied that the character Rupert, played by Jimmy Stewart, who was a young poet, might have had an affair with the character of Brandon. Why was this lost in the American translation and the screenwriter Arthur Laurent had to change it? Because of the Legion of Decency, we imposed a strict code on films at the time. And also, it is not said, but I also learned that it might have been inspired from a true story of two rich kids in Chicago who were killed just for the experience. Watching this movie, a lot of questions emerge. Who decides that they are superior than others?
And I love the guys who say, I watch NASCAR for the racing. Yeah, and I watch porn for the acting. You liar! You watch NASCAR to see Team Viagra spin out in flames and a guy get out with his pubes on fire going, I'm okay! And there was a guy in the South who said, they should have NASCAR in the Olympics. And it's like, mm-hmm. At that moment, even Darwin was going, come with me. This is the ascent of man. You stand here.
Does the perfect murder really exist? Which was also the theme behind Dial M for Murder, another brilliant film from Alfred Hitchcock.
His conclusion was that the only perfect crime that exists is not the one that remains unsolved, but the one which is solved with the wrong culprit.
Does he kill her in the end?
No, she kills him.
The reason why they get caught is clearly stated by Philip. It's also the main reason that serial killers get caught, is that people need recognition for their work, even if it is murder. You can see it in serial killers' habit of collecting trophies from their victims. It is human nature, I believe, because whether you're a charity worker saving lives, a soldier fighting for his country, or a monster serial killer, all you need in the world is to be heard.
Sona, this is what you wanted, isn't it? Somebody else to know. Somebody else to see how brilliant you are, just like at school. I told you we'd find out. But oh no, no, you had to have him here. And now we're done for. Now it'll shut up. You made me do it and I hate you. I hate both of us.
Remember, Rupert?
We are confronted to the same events in the world.
That's all we've done. That's all Philip and I have done.
You will interpret them differently.
And I have lived what you and I have talked.
Just like I'm doing with this movie.
I knew you'd understand, because you have to, don't you see? You have to.
The important thing is to be brave and intelligent enough to face adversity and question your views and discuss them with others. It is a fact that we cannot all have the same point of view, but we have to accept our differences. Only with thoughtful discussions we can communicate and understand each other.
Brandon, until this very moment, this world and the people in it have always been dark and incomprehensible to me. And I've tried to clear my way with logic and superior intellect. And you've thrown my own words right back in my face, Brandon. You were right to, if nothing else, a man should stand by his words. But you've given my words a meaning that I never dreamed of. And you've tried to twist them into a cold, logical excuse for your ugly murder. No, they never were that, Brandon. And you can't make them that. There must have been something deep inside you from the very start that let you do this thing. But there's always been something deep inside me that would never let me do it. And would never let me be a party to it now.
What do you mean?
I mean that tonight you've made me ashamed of every concept I ever had of superior or inferior beings. And I thank you for that shame. Because now I know that we are each of us a separate human being, Brandon, with the right to live and work and think as individuals, but with an obligation to the society we live in. By what right do you dare say that there's a superior few to which you belong? By what right did you dare decide that that boy in there was inferior and therefore could be killed? Did you think you were God, Brandon? Is that what you thought when you choked the life out of him? Is that what you thought when you served food from his grave? Well, I don't know what you thought or what you are, but I know what you've done. You've murdered!
The reason I love any good movie with good character building is that it shows a case study of the characters and teaches us that we are all going through something at any given point in our lives. You will constantly change, and we have to be able to discuss almost everything, because at the end of the day, almost all the concepts have been conceived or the result of human reasoning. So discussing them with your fellow humans is the most human thing to do. I would even go further in saying that it is a sign of respect to treat a fellow human as someone who can handle your curiosity and questioning. For example, the fact that I have the honesty to discuss about your religion, which is a sensitive subject, proves that I respect you more than the concepts we still have difficulties finding logical footing. It is more dangerous to deny others' views and be
And it was like they'd never met. They wanted each other so ferociously, all tooth and claw and jugular. They forgot anything they ever had in common, and scrap like that discard decided between their standing and dying. People just do the strangest things when they believe they're entitled. But they do even stranger things when they just plain believe.